since I've been coming to worship services here at Sanctuary Messianic and the other houses of worship I've been to, I've examined the Word of God as I received it. I've examined not just what is being said in the substance of the Word, but also how it's presented. Can I believe this person? You know, how much are they believing what they're saying? You know, are they credible? And would I do anything different if I were standing there? Well, today I find out. Today I find out. I welcome this opportunity because it gives me a chance to come not just before you souls, you know, in Christ, but also to prove prove my faith and be able to share with you what God's Word is saying to me. So today I want to speak to you from Deuteronomy first, and just go through and share what God's Word is saying to me. In essence, we'll basically reread and then I'll share. In Deuteronomy 7, it says, "Therefore, take care to follow the commands, decrees, and laws I give you today. If you pay attention to these laws and are careful to follow them, then the Lord your God will keep his covenant of love with you as he swore to your ancestors. He will love you and bless you and increase your numbers. He will bless the fruit of your womb, the crops of your land, your grain, new wine and olive oil, the calves of your herds and the lambs of your flocks in the land he swore to your ancestors to give you. You will be blessed more than any other people. None of your men or women will be childless, nor will any of your livestock be without young. The Lord will keep you free from every disease. He will not inflict on you the horrible diseases you knew in Egypt, but he will inflict them on all who hate you." I'll stop there. Brothers and sisters, right away when we read this passage in Deuteronomy, let's look at the context in which the scripture is read. We know the Lord was speaking to his people, Israel, as they were coming out of captivity, right? And he was giving them every assurance that things will be well with them on condition. Hi, Jenny.
Hi.
He was giving them every assurance that things will be well with them on condition of their keeping his commands, decrees, and his statutes, his laws. That hasn't changed. God hasn't changed, right? Today we can look at ourselves and kind of see ourselves as coming out of places we've been in our lives, coming out of some form of captivity or another. We could look at ourselves and say, well, I've been in a place where I've struggled with certain habits, practices. I grew up in a home situation where things just wasn't right, you know. This was the way our family did things, and I felt burdened by it. This is some of the things that happened inside my family that was so wrong morally. And we can look at ourselves today and just, you know, see a change. Look back and see the road we've traveled. And we could easily tell ourselves, well, look upon ourselves as we're the ones who shook free from that. Or we could recognize God's grace in setting us free from our you know, struggles and our bondage. Some of us have been through physical illnesses that might have taken us down, threatened to take our lives. And we could look at ourselves today and see God's grace in that our bodies are better, you know, whether physically, whether it was a physical disease or mental or something, but we could see God's grace in how he has blessed us and been faithful to us. But we need to look further and examine ourselves and see, have we been faithful in keeping his commandments? Have we, you know, lay hold of the things he wants us to do to keep our part of the covenant with him? You know, and as far as that is concerned, then I think for each one of us in here, we could we would readily agree that that is an ever ongoing process of change, isn't it? Every day we have to examine ourselves, and when we do, we can see that in some cases we might have fallen back into bad habits, or we might have been we might recognize that we are doing a little bit better than the day before, you know. Either way, it's a product of our obedience. It's a product of our obedience. And I want to submit to you today that unless we are ever diligent to remain obedient to our Lord, then we will fall back into bad habits, bad practices, and the evils of our nature or carnal nature will overtake us. Deuteronomy 7 just really does a lot to show us God's love. In verse 13, he talks about he will love you and bless you and increase your numbers. He will bless the fruit of your womb, the crops of your land, your grain, your new wine, and olive oil, the calves of your herds and the lambs of your flocks in the land he swore to your ancestors to give to you. This is a blessing that God promises to bestow on not just us individually, but on an entire nation of people. Right here, we know he was speaking to the nation of Israel, but today we know he's speaking to all of us who believe, to all of us who keep his commandments, right? Because he loves not just Israel. His love hasn't changed, God hasn't changed, and to each of us who has come to faith in him and want to keep his commands, he will bestow these blessings upon us. Okay? We know that God is a God of increase, because it says in verse 14, you will be blessed more than any other people. None of your men or women will be childless. You know, so just like he promised to Abraham to bless his seed and make his children more plenty than the sands on the beach or stars in the sky, you know, we see him repeating that promise here again, that if we keep his commands, he will increase not just our sustenance by what we have in the land that we live in, what we need as far as food, but also our offspring, our children will be plenty. And we will be blessed more than any other people. This reminds me that we are a peculiar people in Christ, that there's a comparison going on here. He says you will be blessed more than any other people, right? And again, it reminds me that Scripture says that by their fruits you will know them, right? Mm-hmm. By our fruits, others will know us. So if we're connected to the Holy One in how we live our lives through our obedience to his word, we should start seeing the fruits of his blessing. People around us, our neighbors, our friends, strangers should see something in us, something of God in us, that will you know, I'll be strong in saying this, that will force them to recognize that we are blessed by him, mm-hmm. right? So let's skip over right now to Isaiah 49. I believe scripture always backs itself up. So let's skip over to Isaiah 49. And if somebody has it before me, can you go ahead and just reread verse 14 through 16, please.
But Zion said, "The Lord has forsaken me, and the Lord has forgotten me. Can a woman forget a nursing child and have no compassion on the son of her womb? Even these may forget, but I will not forget you. Behold, I have inscribed you on the palms of my hands. Your walls are continually before me."
Kashim, thank you, Evan. So, give me a second just so I could see for myself. But Isaiah 49, we know the Lord is saying that he will never leave us or forsake us. Right? He compares his love to the love of a mother suckling her young. Very intimate moment, right? Something that as a man I cannot really relate to, except if I go back in memory to when my mom nursed me, right? It's a very strong bond that's formed at during this time in our lives. And world over, this image is used to present just a strong bond between mother and child, right? And the Lord compares his love and devotion to us to this picture. He says, if a mother cannot forget the child suckling on her breast, how much more will he not forget us? Amen?
Amen.
All right. Is this making sense? All right. I haven't found it yet on my little thing here, so I'm just going to keep it moving and go to Romans 8. Barbara, can you read from Romans 8, please, 31 through 39?
Sure.
31
through 39.
Yes.
What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen. Brothers and sisters, we can see already, just real quickly, if we review what we read in Deuteronomy, Isaiah, and Romans, we can see the incredible devotion God has to us, his children. We could see a declaration of his promise, right? That nothing can separate us from his love. You know, he wants to be in covenant with us. And he wants us to know that how incredibly faithful and devoted he is to us. He says, who can separate us from his love? And I want to ask you to just reflect on that for a minute, because when he says who, I think he's not just talking about the other person we know or we have in our lives that we might be at odds with, right? Maybe we might want to think further about issues. I started off speaking on some of the trials and just stuff we've been through as far as sickness and family issues, whatever. I want to submit to you that nothing that we've been through can separate us from His love. Of course, when we're going through our circumstances, we probably get to a point where we feel isolated. We get to a point where we internalize stuff and we wonder, how am I going to get through this? You know, if it's something that's brought upon us by a relationship with, I don't know, people at the job, again, family, friends, that really changed our circumstances. I know some years ago I went through a layoff from a very well-paying job, and I remember the mood around the office, because we were all going to be laid off, right? During the time of the contract, when there was work and it seemed like there would be no end to it, people were just in an upbeat mood. People, you know, it would be commonplace for you to walk through the office and hear people talk about plans they had to travel, to move and move into a better place, to just, I don't know, just do things. It was a time of plenty, no worries. And then it was announced like maybe 6 months before the end of the contract that the company was going to shut down, it was going to go away. And very quickly, the mood around the office changed. You no longer heard people talking of what they were going to do this week or next week or and buying anything. Instead, you start hearing news of other bad news outside of the company, things that was going on across the nation. So people were looking for ways to comfort themselves, I guess, by trying to relate to other negative stuff that was going on. You know, folks started to wonder where are they going to be able to find another well-paying job. They had taken on expenses, and we're just wondering now where the money was going to come from and how their lives were going to change. And sure enough, the end of the contract came around, and the company laid off people, like, in, I guess they had a certain order of priority as far as who was needed, who would be needed until the last day, when they finally closed doors. And as folks started to watch the first batch of group walk through the door, pack up their stuff and walk out, the mood around the office got even more solemn. It just really got, you know, there wasn't chatter from one cubicle to the other like before.